teacher's investigations is almost endless. That's why their burden is to welcome PhD Margaret Thomas. Very exciting. So I told everybody I wanted to be a lawyer. Then I had a remarkable set of high school science teachers. And we had a lot of science in my high school. Not as much as you have here, but we had certainly chemistry and physics, but also geology and meteorology. Other technical sciences. And I was so impressed with my teachers because of the way that they taught me about science. They taught me, we would have a class, but then when something happened in the world that was related to the science, they would tell me exactly how it was related. And I can still remember, for example, President of the United States had a heart attack, and everybody was talking about this special drug that he was given as for his heart attack symptoms. And my biology teacher just took that apart, as we say, you know, unpacked it, and talked to us about why a drug would help a heart attack. He diagrammed the chemistry, the chemical formula on the board. We talked about how recently that drug had been developed and that it was a result of science and technology that the president was being helped. And every other aspect of regular life, whether it was something about the food that we ate or the river that ran through the town, they explained. And so all of a sudden, I began to understand that science was really all around me, that it wasn't people in a laboratory with white coats pouring green stuff into blue stuff. It was about the world that I lived in. And that made me very excited about science. So when I went to college, I went into science. But I was still a little uncertain about what brand of science I wanted to be in. So every semester, I would fall in love with so first I majored in biochemistry, and then I majored in microbiology, and I went through three or four different sciences before I wound up in geology. And my undergraduate study was geology. And that brings up one of the other things that I love about science. Unlike so many fields where most of your study and most of your work is in an office with papers and so forth, much of science brings you in contact with the real world. So we had many field trips in all over the U.S. For my geology major. And if it wasn't out in the field, it was in the laboratory, it was an opportunity to really physically be doing something as well as just studying. And it's one of the things that I really love about science, that sense of experimentation, and that we don't know all the answers. And I look at things that were in my textbook at the time, and for example, in biology, so much has changed. At the time that I went to school, we didn't know how DNA worked. We didn't know about molecular genetics. We didn't know about the human microbiome and the fact that of the cells in our body, most of them are something other than us because they're bacteria and viruses and so forth. So it's not done. There's a lot of work to be done, and there's a lot of work for you to do. And that's another thing that I really love about science, that we don't know the answers, all of the answers yet. And there's lots of room for all of you to contribute to the way that we understand the world. When I graduated from college, I had been studying geology, and I studied the geology of sediments, the rocks that form in the water from rivers and the ocean and so forth. And at the time, we knew a lot about deltas and rivers and beaches and coastlines, but we didn't know so much about the deep ocean. And this was the whole discovery of plate tectonics and the way that the big continental plates move and the evolution of the Earth. Those papers had just been published when I was in college. And so we were just beginning to understand that. And I said, in order to understand the evolution of the Earth and the rocks, I should go and study the ocean because that's where this is all happening. So I went into oceanography. Another piece of what I have loved about science is the opportunity to talk with people all over the world. I know very, very few scientists who don't depend on the science that's done by scientists in other countries and around the world. We all read published papers by scientists around the world. There are so many opportunities to go to meetings all over the world. As I said, I've been in Argentina four times. Each time has been a science meeting. And that ability to get to know people from around the world is also very characteristic of science. It's very international. And as we say in the U.S., science is a team sport rather than an individual sport. So there's lots of opportunity to work together. That's another piece that I really like. A final piece that I want to mention is the range of jobs that are available in science. Certainly there are a lot of scientists that are in universities, So that's another piece that I like. And the last thing that I want to mention is how people respect scientists. They respect the fact that we use the scientific method, that we are focused on things that can be demonstrated rather than just opinion. And they respect the fact that scientists have invested so much in their understanding and learning. So around the world, when they do polls of the general population, and they say, you know, how much do you respect people in this kind of job versus others, science always is very close to the top. Unlike lawyers, remember that was the first job that I wanted to, that I thought about, yeah. So, and I just wanted to mention, we are celebrating International Women's Day, and I was asked to feature some women that I know that are famous scientists. So I'm going to mention five or six that are personal friends. One, Dr. Catherine Sullivan, she just stepped down from being the administrator of the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration in the U.S. But before that, she was a geologist. And before that, she was an astronaut. So she was
questions to both of you first. The first one is about the first I have to study. There's not necessary about creating things, yeah? When I get older in 2 years, I have to decide if I want to be an engineer or an architect. The problem is that, besides, I love that, and you know, since I was a child, I was drawing houses. The problem is that I'm in love of quantum physics. I'm in love of that. But here in Argentina, it's difficult to get the work related to that. I don't know, I have 2 years to decide, but I don't know if someone who has gone through a lawyer to a scientist, how can I decide what to follow? Because here an architect or an engineer has a future, has lots of things to do, and needs a lot of money, but a scientist is not. Yeah, so that is the first question, how can I decide what I want to do, what I want to do, what should I do?
Well, I think that one of the things that's important is to reach out to people that are in those fields, and your school can help you connect, or the internet can help you connect, to talk to them about what their experience is like. What is it like every day to be an architect or to do architectural work? What is it like every day to be an engineer and do engineering? What is it like to be a physicist and do that? Because ultimately, it's about about being able to go to work every day and be happy that you're doing what you're doing. If you aren't, it's a very long life doing that other thing that then just becomes a way to make money instead of something that gives you pleasure and gives you feeling of satisfaction.
I would like to work with someone that I like, but I would like to give it my I would like to give them a good life. So if I'm happy but I don't bring enough money to give them a education or something else, I don't know, because I would prefer to work with something that I don't like that much, but to give them a good life. But I would like to do something for more, like studying new quantum physics or something like that. So that's the goal.
I think the most important thing is for you to talk to people who are actually doing that and get a sense of whether there are, whether in the science jobs that you're interested in, that people say that they make enough to take care of their families. And I don't know about the specifics here in Argentina, but talk with them and be informed about what people say, as opposed to what you might hear from others.
Yes, I found money. You have seen that the movie was a few times old. There was a protest because the amount of money that was given to scientists in general, no specific subject, but it was cut by, I don't know if the half of how much, but they have no money, and that is the problem. In Germany, in the story of Argentina, it was like that. The scientists had not a lot of money, and now it's even less. So that is what I'm afraid of. But I don't know if it's worth it to win a bit less instead of being happy.
Right. I understand.
Okay. The other thing, question I wanted to ask, it was not about fully, but it's something software. What do you think about, you have seen that part of the challenge larger country, I don't know, more or less, has lots of planes and lots of places where we can get something. What do you think about making, using that environment to use, for energy, for big places, for solar panels, or
designs,
whatever, I don't know, some kind of energy.
So the last question was about using the open space for energy generation, solar U.S. and I expect we'll have more, is that people are moving away from the idea of giant solar installations to more community, not individual, not just solar on my house, but community solar generation. And with the changes that are happening in that industry, I think that there's going to be a lot of new technology and capability in the future. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Please try again.
Okay. Is that
better? Okay. Yes. How has Fukushima disaster affected the Pacific Ocean?
The question was about the Fukushima nuclear disaster in Japan and how that affected the Pacific Ocean. The immediate effect was the release of enormous quantities of radiation into the Pacific Ocean. Some of that radiation is very short-lived, so it was it's already gone. Other of that radiation is very long-lived. And there are two kinds of concerns. One is about the radiation that is in the water and moving around with the water. The other is about radiation in organisms. So there have been many studies of organisms, especially fish, out in the middle of the Pacific to see whether they have been affected by the radiation. There is no evidence of radiation, but it is a very, very small amount, so small that it wouldn't affect us. That's for the Pacific Ocean far away from Fukushima. So that is not a danger to us. There are still, however, concern about the radiation very close to Fukushima. And of course, fish swim. They don't just stay in one place. So the question is, how much are fisheries in the area around Japan being affected by the radiation? So in Japan, there's a very active program of monitoring the amount of radiation in fish to ensure that any fish that are sold in markets So that's one big effect, and how it's different in different parts of the ocean. The second is radiation in the water itself. One of the most important things is that there are the kinds of radiation that are go into materials that are soluble and stay with the water. Most of that radiation is not very powerful radiation, and it's so it's more like natural radiation that you just get from the box. And the radiation that is around the area also has been incredibly diluted. So in spite of the fact that there was a lot of radiation, the amount of water in the ocean is incredibly big. And so much of that radiation is very, very much diluted. So there wouldn't be a problem or a safety problem being in the Pacific Ocean far away from the area right around the ocean. So in a very close area, obviously a big problem, but much further away, not something that you have to worry about in terms of eating fish or being near the water. So the deep ocean, now is this nature of your question about things like deep sea mining or changes in the ocean related to changes in the ocean? Okay. What the deep ocean, and I'll define that as the ocean deeper than about 500 meters. Is most of the ocean, and it is also connected with the surface. So we know that the ocean is warming. We are now able to measure that very, very accurately. But because the ocean is so big, it's warming very slowly. Nonetheless, it is warming, and one of the things that we're trying to understand is what the implications of that warming are for ocean life. We're interested in sort of two areas. One is how will the warming affect the organisms in the oceans, like the small microscopic organisms that are the base of the food chain. And the second is, how will it affect the way that the ocean circulates? Right now, in terms of the way that the ocean circulates, we're not seeing major changes, and we're not seeing changes that would result in effects for us or for your generation. It could be changing the ocean in ways that would affect it hundreds of years from now, but not right now. The second is, what about the organisms in the ocean? We're definitely seeing the effects of climate change on that. And I'll give you a couple of examples. We're seeing fish that are part of fisheries, the kinds of fish that are about that. The second is, dissolves in the ocean. And just like agua syngas has a higher pH than agua cangas, the pH of the ocean is going down a little bit. National Science Foundation, which provides funding to GLOBE through NASA. And so I was very aware of the program and what it does. So I was delighted when the embassy told me about the school and that you were involved in GLOBE. And of course, you're a techie school. I don't think they would have invited me if it was a school for the arts.
Well, the next one says, is there any endangered species due to global warming? I think the major species, I don't know, I think most of the species are endangered, but I think they refer to the major ones.
So the question was whether there are species endangered by global warming. There are certainly species that people are worried about. Most of those are species that have restricted ranges and that are very dependent on a certain temperature regime or a certain amount of rainfall. I have to say, there are many more species endangered by our activity in terms of altering their habitat. Then we've done much more by hunting, by fishing, and by altering habitat than we're seeing now from climate change. It doesn't mean that it's not happening as a result of climate change, but so far the big impact has been us taking species, taking organisms out of the environment or changing their environment by cutting down trees or farming or any of the other things that we do.
Thank you.
Okay. Which is held every year during your winter break, so summer in the U.S.
If you go to the embassy's Facebook page, wait a second. There you see information, and we accept applications. Especially, we always look for more females to apply, so I hope some of you will. And then one other program that we have is called the Jóvenes Embajadores, or the Youth Ambassadors Program. Has anyone heard of that? Questions? Okay. So that's another exchange program where we send 13 Argentine youth from all across Argentina. Every year, they travel in